morning, Refuge Church. Good morning, good morning. Welcome. We are so excited that you're tuning in with us. Whether you're in person or online, there is no better place to be than in the house of the Lord. So my name is Alicia Vallejo, and I get the privilege of getting to be with one of our interns this morning.
Hi, I'm Zach.
Yes, he's Zach. Zach, so I have a question for you. What has been one of your highlights during the internship so far?
One of my highlights of this internship would be for 4th of July, we got blessed to just go to a lake house and just go tubing, and it was really exciting. It was fun, but also whenever we fell off the tubing, man, it was just like I was just in the water, and it was just so dark, couldn't see anything, and I kind of got scared, but I was like, man, nothing can touch me. I got God.
Praise God. Yeah, I saw you guys with your life jackets out there and everything. So kind of a metaphor for life, huh? Deep waters. Yeah. But you got to trust him. He's got you. Okay, great. So I have another question. So I'm glad that was one of your highlights because, getting to be out there with you guys, just getting to watch y'all in the fellowship and, the camaraderie with everybody. It's been such a beautiful thing to see over the course of the past 5 weeks. But I do want to know, what is something that, how are you feeling? Where's your head at right now since we're about to start the last week of the 6-week internship?
I'm kind of thankful for just everything that this internship has given me and just all that they've done for me and how much I've changed in just a few amount of weeks than how much I've changed in a year. And I've changed more than I ever thought I would change. And I'm just kind of sad, honestly. I'm going to miss everybody. I'm just going to miss just the bonds we created. And I hope that we can just continue to just see each other outside of the internship.
I was like, don't cry. You're going to make me cry. what would you say is like, if someone were to say, well, why did you join the internship? What would you say to that? Like, what's one way that you can encourage somebody that might be hearing all these testimonies thinking like, I don't know if that's for me?
I would say to just jump right into it. I mean, there's just when God wants you to do something, you just do it. You can't really just take a second guess and just be like, oh, should I do it? But then at that point, it's just, you're not doing it for him. You're just doing it for yourself and just taking on his glory, and you just, whenever he asks you to do something, you just jump right into it, and you just give him honor and glory, and man, that's what I did. I showed up with nothing, and I've changed so much, and I'm so thankful for everybody, and I'm so thankful for God.
Praise God. What is one, what is the first thing you're going to do when the internship is up, when it's over?
I'm going to take a 3-day nap. Even man, I just can't wait to go just lay on my bed and just, this is how I feel. The beds we've got, we got beds, so I'm thankful for that. But some of them are just, feels like I'm sleeping on the floor.
Yeah, it's not easy. It's not easy. I see you guys just snoozing off every now and again, but that's funny. So a 3-day nap is in order once this internship is over.
That's the usual.
Honestly, I feel that because it's a lot. It's a lot to be with them. We wake up with them. We eat with them. We're with you guys all the time. You're with me all the time. I'm like.
Yeah, we just need the nap, we're so busy. We have to get up early in the morning. Sometimes we might get on each other's nerves, but it's just because we need a good nap, a good nap or just a good bed.
Amen. No, it's biblical, right? Yeah. Sometimes all you need is a snack and a nap. A lot of our problems can be cured. No, well, that's great. So what is one thing that you're looking forward to during the course of this last week? If there's one thing that you're just like, man, I just want to make sure that I make the most of this.
I just want to just be able to just, so in the beginning of the internship, we worshiped a lot, together as us interns, and I just wanted us to just have another opportunity to just worship on the last night, specifically that last night, because I feel like our life is going to change so much. And I'm so excited for this week.
Praise God. No, yeah, definitely. So tune in next week for our worship night. We'll be in person. You are more than welcome to join us. But today we get the privilege of having a missionary. And we know that missions is the heart of God. We have a special guest, missionary Hannah Ibarra, from Japan. So we're so excited for that. But in this moment, Refuge, whether you're in person or online, we just invite you to get ready to worship with us. So go ahead and get up on your feet, remove all distractions, and let's get ready to worship God this morning.
Welcome, church.
Hello. Hallelujah. God is good. Amen. Can you say with me, God is good? Let's go ahead and lift up our hands this morning and say, God, thank you because you've allowed us to be here today. And we're nothing without you, God. And we want to enter this moment into your presence and worship you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. in front of me. You are greater. You're so much greater. And greater than the power of the enemy. You are greater. So much greater. And greater than the mountain. And that's in front of me. You are greater. You're so much greater.
Today that there's moments sometimes from Monday to Saturday that maybe we don't feel like he's so great, that you're like, oh, I'm not going to admit that, right? But there's sometimes we're going through something and then they gave us a report maybe at the doctor and you're like, man, but I was told God is greater. Or maybe you're going through something financially and you feel like, but where's God? Or maybe something in your marriage or with your kids, and it's so easy. Because this song talks about the giants, right? The giants that we face. And at least in that moment, it seems like the giants are so much greater than the God that we serve. But can I talk to somebody here today? Y'all familiar with the story of David and Goliath? Right? Y'all remember? And I'm getting just excited and chills just saying this. But listen, David was a lot smaller than the giant. But he says, you come to me with a javelin and a sword. With all your skill, with all your height and all your muscles. But I come in the name of the Lord of hosts. Can I help somebody today? You may be looking at the sword and the javelin. You may be looking at the sickness and what you're going through. But there's a God that's greater. There's a God that's bigger. There's a God that wants to do something in your life. Why don't you give him some praise today? Why don't you give him some glory today? He's great. He's great. Hallelujah. Yeah. Thank you, Jesus. And when you don't feel like he's great, praise him. When it doesn't seem like he's great, praise him. When it's not showing up like you think it should show up, praise him. Because in all situations, he's great. Can you do me one more favor? Can we give a big hand clap to the Lord today? Because he's worthy to be praised. Amen. Anybody excited to be here today? Anybody know that you're not here by accident or coincidence? But somebody, a friend invited me. Hey, yeah, that's true. But you're not here by coincidence. God has a plan for your life. And we're excited to have you. If you are here for the first, second, or even say third time, Refuge Church, can you help me out? Can we give it up for our guests today? Come on, let's give it up for our guests. Let's show them how excited we are to have them here today. We've even got Pastor Ruth here, special guest all the way. I'm so glad you're here. If you're watching online, I say this anytime I'm emceeing. I say this. I know, guys, in the day and age we live in, so many different churches you could connect to. But the fact that you're watching us today, thank you. Thank you for choosing us. And we choose you. We love you. And yes, we always, if you can be here in person, we want you here. But we also get it. Maybe you're on vacation right now. Brother Marco, I hope you're watching. I'm kidding. I'm sorry to call out names, right? But I hope all you guys are connecting with us today. Amen. And so, guys, here we have a value. We believe in big hugs and big smiles. And so we try every Sunday not just to kind of give a few high fives, but to really go out of your seats and go hug somebody. And we want to do that again today. Now, let me say something before we do that. Concerning offering today, just for the sake of order and clarification so you have a good understanding. Here in a few moments, after testimonies about the internship and other things, we're going to have our weekly offering, tithes and offering. We're going to pick it up, right? And so be ready for that. If you normally give your tithes, this is going to be your time after the redefined testimonies and drama they're going to do. But then we're also, today it's a special day because it's also Mission Sunday. And we have a missionary with us today, all right? Missionary to Japan. And so we're going to also pick up a missionary offering at the end of service, okay? So I just wanted to clarify that. There's going to be two different times. The one where we give our tithes and offerings. We've learned the blessing of giving tithes weekly unto God. But then there are also special moments and special occasions we give an extra special blessing. And today it's about missions. And so, guys, will you do me a favor? Before we ever give any kind of monetary offering, how about we give an offering of kindness, an offering of love, an offering of some hugs? Go find somebody today. Get out of your seats and say, man, I like your smile. Tell them, come on. Make that person smile. Smiles are contagious. Tell them you like their smile.
Zach, I like your smile.
Alicia, I like your smile.
Yeah, here at Refuge, we believe in giving big hugs and big smiles. So I know you're not here in person, but we send you a big hug right where you are. And if you're on vacation, enjoy your vacation. We send you love and hugs all the way from wherever you find yourself today. But just like our pastor said, like, God is just so good. I don't know. It's just, sometimes I know it's easier to, like, watch online and stuff, but honestly, like, you do not want to miss out on the move of God. Like, worship is powerful. The presence of God is in this place. And we're so excited for the word that will be shared here in a little bit. But we just wanted to greet Alicia Alvarado, Adriana Cruz, and the few others that are watching us online this morning. We thank you for tuning in. And just don't forget, you can always comment. We would love to engage with you and just hear about your week. How are you? Is there ways that we can pray for you today?
Well, Refuge, we're just going to continue the service and just prepare your hearts for what's next.
Good morning, Refuge Church. Lily and all three of us. All three of us are part of the year three of the Redefine internship, and all three of us are going to give our testimony today. So, for those of you who don't know me or have never met me before, my name is Lily, and I grew up in church my whole life. And 2 years ago, I was in the wrong place mentally and in situations that I should have never been in. But 2 years ago, during like New Year's Eve service is when I really, truly, fully rededicated my life to Christ. And I made the vow to myself and unto God that I would serve him for the rest of my life, no matter what situation I get into. During that time, mentally, I wasn't there. And 2 years ago was when the first Redefined internship had started. And the first year and the second year, my mom prayed that I would join the internship. And I was like, Mom, I'm never doing that. Don't even think about it. I'm never going to do it. And the crazy thing is that when I rededicated my life to Christ, God told me in January that I was going to do the internship. And the internship doesn't even start till like June. So it was just like really crazy. But in the midst of me not serving God, I was just going through so much in my life and like throughout high school and just everything. And I began to forget like who I was in Christ. I began to forget the type of person that I was. I didn't have any more joy inside of me. I began to become a person that where I didn't even recognize who I was anymore. And I began to question what I was supposed to do in my life. Like, I felt like I had no purpose anymore. And until that moment, until like a couple months, towards the beginning of the year when I fully really rededicated my life, about like 2 years ago or so, God reminded me why I'm here on this earth. And he reminded me that I'm not part of this world. He made me to be a part for a reason. And he reminded me what my purpose and what my calling is in my life and the things that I'm supposed to be doing for a reason. And it's just to reach the souls around the world and to preach the good news, to preach the gospel, and just to share that God can still do the same thing that he did then many years ago and what he's doing now in all of our lives and just everyone in the internship. And so I'm just so grateful for the opportunity that God has given Pastor to be able to start this Redefined internship, because it literally what our motto is, your life is about to change, your life will change, because my life is changed by the blood of Jesus Christ.
Hello, I'm Eric. Everybody calls me Bubba. Okay. When I was younger, maybe like 13 or 12. I had lost my cousin. Due to a car crash. I didn't know how to deal with it. I had so mixed emotions. It caused me to have anger. Depression. But God taught me something. He taught me to be more like him. He molded me. But this internship has kind of helped me open up. I'm just thankful for the group we have right now. I'm thankful for every single one of y'all guys. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Tiffany. Prior to the internship, like the beginning of the year, a lot was going on with my family, and it caused me to be really angry. Like, I've always had an angry heart. Like, I've never been happy. I've never been sad. It was either I was happy or I was mad. Like, I was angry. And so I was struggling with that, and so it just got to the point where I was, like, I ran from my problems. Instead of, like, facing God, I I left my family. I moved to Arkansas with my grandparents. And at first, during the days, I was always distracted. I was always out with my grandma. And at night, that's when, it hit. And I was like, God, where are you? Like, I felt alone. It was really bad. And it's just, prior to that, and my mom used to ask me, what can I do for you to stay? And I had to tell her, I'm like, because a lot of it had to do with my father. Me and my father were going through stuff. And I was like, leave him. Like, if you want me to stay so bad, I want you to leave him. It's me or him. And of course, if you know my family, I have other siblings. And so it was she couldn't just leave him because, I said so. They were working through her marriage. And so I left and I had my bumps in the road. And I told my mom one time, and I was like, I'm not doing the internship. I'm going to stay here. Regardless of, in my heart, I wanted to go home. I was like, no, I'm staying in Arkansas. And so, my mom sent me a picture of my little sister, Emily. If you know Emily, she's this happiest little girl. She was at the women's conference, and she was at the altar, and she was crying. My mom sent me that picture, and she did, no explanation, just sent it. And that, really, made me so sad. I was like, oh, my goodness. And then one day in May, late May, I went on the Refuge Sunday service live, and it was a remnant worship singing Yeshua. And I was on my phone, and I just started crying. And I was like, and then that night I told my mom, I was like, Mom, I want to go home. Like, not only with my family, but I want to go home because, Refuge was my home. Not only did my family, but I left my home. And so my mom, she got it all gathered up, and I was able to come here. And, the Sunday back, I was just crying. It was Mother's Day, and I was crying and crying. And then I was so thankful. I was like, God, thank you for getting me here. And I still had those that problem, the anger in my heart. And I told my mom, I was like, Mom, I'm going to do this internship, but I don't expect you to expect for me to forgive, forgive my father. And the motto is, your life's about to change. And to me, it's like, oh, a little of your life's going to change. And so when I started this internship, the first night, the girls were there, all the past interns, and I told them, I was like, guys, oh my God, I told him everything. I was ugly crying. It was so bad. And so after that happened in the RCYA night, Joseph Baca preached over. And at the end, he's like God speaking to me that there's broken homes, that they want to be restored. And I was just crying at the altar. Alejandra prayed for me. And then that broke all the walls. It was starting to break. And after that, it was people were pouring into me about forgiveness. And they Jonathan Cervantes told me that God spoke to him. And he said that, while you were carrying your hurt, so was God. And that was oh my God, sorry. And after that, it was the Friday of Adventure Days, the last days. I told the girls, I was like, girls, you know what? I'm going to forgive my father. I'm going to say my sorries. I'm going to forgive him. So, so that night we ran home to pass the Iglesias home, and I ran on the floor, and I was like, I told Alexa, play music. And then I got on my phone, and I started crying. And then I was like, text this whole paragraph. And I'm like, because I was at fault too. Like, it just wasn't on him. It was on me too. Like, I was an angry daughter. I was a mean daughter. And I was like, I'm sorry. Like, I'm sorry. And I forgive you. And I want you to forgive me. And then, it was that Friday before Father's Day. And I was glad that I was able to forgive him and to be set free, because I always thought that I was holding him captive, but really it was me. And I was like, I was tied up in these chains of hate and unforgiveness. And so this internship, it really, really, was a big thing for me. And then now, after that, I'm just like, thank you, God. And then yesterday night, Remnant was singing Yeshua, and I was praying, and I was like, thank you. Thank you for getting me to where I am. And, I'm so grateful. And I love Remnant, and I love Redefine. I love you guys. Thank you.
I know them.
She said, Whoa, wait a minute. That, you're done. That was fast.
Yep.
I mean, I need details. Did you talk to her in a dream? Those usually go a little smoother.
Nope. God said he wanted me to do this one face to face.
Well, how did you go?
What do you mean?
Well, did you disguise your angelness a little bit?
My angelness?
You know what I mean.
No, I went like this.
You wore that.
Oh, what's wrong with my robe? Is my halo crooked? I mean, I looked fine in the mirror before.
You look fine.
You scared me for a minute there. God said that this one was important, so I just wanted to look my best.
I mean, I'm just shocked it went so well. I mean, she is a human.
Well, I mean, she was a little scared at first.
Oh, okay, so you have to do the whole fear not speech.
Yep.
Yeah, what about is so frightening? I don't understand.
I mean, seriously, in Human Interaction 101, I thought memorizing the fear not speech was going to be frivolous.
I mean, according to my notes, that is the one that's used the most.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, well, like, did she have any questions?
No, she didn't have any questions.
She didn't... Brother. Well, what was Mary's response? I mean, after the whole, I'm Gabriel, don't be afraid thing.
Well, I just told her she was going to have a baby.
And?
Well, I did actually think that one a little bit.
Right?
Well, I mean, then she just said, I am the Lord's servant. I mean, I'm trying to remember it exactly.
Wait. There weren't any more questions? Like what? Like, how am I supposed to jail Joseph? You told her you'd be appearing to him in a dream, right?
No.
Really? What about how am I going to explain this to my parents?
No, I mean, I didn't tell her. I mean, God didn't tell me to.
Come on.
Well, I God didn't tell me to. Do you really think that's going to be a problem?
Do I think that's going to be a problem? Mom, Dad, I'm pregnant, but don't worry, God did it.
I'm beginning to see your point.
Yeah, did she even mention what she should do? She should be shunned, or if the town wanted to stone her? I mean, this is going to be looked at as adultery.
Mary didn't commit adultery.
I know that, you know that, but who else is going to believe that she saw an angel? I mean, we don't just appear to everyone.
Although lately my errands have been picking up.
I've noticed.
I mean, Zachariah was a trip.
That one seemed to take a little longer.
Well, I mean, with all of the, how can I be sure? Isn't my wife too old? Aren't I too old? I mean, yada, yada, yada. That man can talk.
Well, at least he used to.
Yeah, right.
I mean, I'm just surprised it went so well. You know, she didn't even bother asking, like, why he decided to go out as a baby. I mean, I'm still questioning that one.
No, she just said, I am the Lord's servant. May it be to me as you have said.
Wow. You sure that's verbatim?
Yep. I mean, what version are you?
The New International.
Good. Okay, well, hey, I've got to appear to Joseph in a dream.
And then you have to get that choir ready. Last practice was sounding a little pitchy.
Pitchy?
I'm just saying it's going to be a silent night. One wrong note in an a cappella choir group is going to be recorded for the ages.
Those herald angels will be hearkening key.
Come on, can we give it up for these guys? I am so proud of them. Every week, you guys know, we're hitting the last week. This is the last week of our internship. But whoever's come to testify, most of them get horrified having to come in front of people. And I'm so proud of them because they have done such a good job. All the last weeks, this week, the testimonies, and then even them developing their little bit of their drama skills as well. God is doing something really good in their life. Amen. And so I'm just, just super, super proud of what God is doing in their life and can't believe one more week. Let me take advantage and say this really quickly as a quick announcement, is that I invite you guys to come back because next week in the morning, they're going to finish it off with a group drama and some other things in the morning. And then at night, we have our night of worship where you'll have the graduation for the interns as well as a night of worship. They're going to put together a couple songs together with the worship team. So I want to invite you guys to come back. At the same time, I invite you to stand up. I'm going to ask you to stand up really quickly. Forgive us, guys. Today, there's a lot of different things that we're going on in the service. The core, the center of it all is the Word of God. So please still be in anticipation for what God wants to share sharing what God wants to challenge in your life. But a couple weeks ago, we brought back the offering time during service, right? Like we used to just, on the way out, the offering baskets that most of you give online, Tithely, the app that we use. But we just felt like for the summer, this would be a good time to go ahead and give some space once again to some offering time and just give a little bit more, I guess, linger to when we're giving unto God. But how many know that it's always more blessed, according to Scripture, more blessed to give than to receive? Do y'all know that? That's what the Bible says. I truly believe He's taught us to be a generous people. It's not my principle, it's God's. He tells us to be generous. And the more we give, the more God always blesses us. And so here at this moment, I ask you if you can prepare your tithes and offerings. That's if you're the person that likes to give it here in person. Like I said, I know most of you probably still give it online in some sort. But maybe pull out your phone and get ready as we give unto God. Just let me say a quick prayer. Father, we come before You and we thank You, God, for who You are. We thank You for Your word. We thank You for what You're doing. We thank You because You are a great and mighty God. And so in this moment, I just ask You, God, Lord, to bless Your people. Bless Your people. As we'll repeat that scripture again. It's more blessed to give than to receive. We know that's not just a financial principle. We give of our time. We give of our love. We give of our faith to others. But there are moments, obviously, where Scripture tells us about those monetary blessings. You don't ask us to give because you need it. You're the owner of everything. God, You ask us to give it because we need it. Yeah, it's our way to stay surrendered and connected to You and keep that heart of gratitude and that heart of generosity, Lord. Bless Your people today. In Your precious name we pray. Amen and amen. All right, bring your offerings and let's keep this going.
Welcome to Refuge Church.
We love that you're having church with us today.
Here are a few things you need to know.
There are many ways to connect with your Refuge community. You can find us on social media through Facebook or Instagram.
To receive information on Refuge events, text the word REFUGE to 94000. We would love to connect with you.
Tribes are happening every Friday all over our city. Get connected to the tribe in your area because we believe that church isn't just what we do.
It's who we are. To find your tribe and join your small group, check out our website at refugefw.org. If you're on site, you can give today by dropping off your offerings in the boxes located at each exit.
You can always give by using the Tithely app or by visiting our website at refugefw.org.
There's many things happening here at Refuge that we would love for you and your family to enjoy.
Today, we have a guest speaker, missionary Hannah Ibarra. We are excited for the
good news
that will be shared today.
Next Sunday, we begin a new sermon series titled, A Summer's Journey. We will journey through the book of James during July and August.
Prayer service is this Wednesday at 7 p.m. We will not be having Tuesday night prayer this month, so make sure to mark your calendar. We hope to see you there.
Next Sunday is our Redefine Worship Night. Join us that evening and invite your friends and your family for a powerful night in God's presence.
If you're in need of prayer for any reason, comment below or reach out to one of our leaders and pastors here today. We would love the chance to partner with you in prayer.
No matter where we gather, in person or online, we believe that your life is about to change. Now, Refuge Church, let's prepare our hearts for what's next. We'll be right back.
where my remnant people at? Where's Redefined at? And we had an amazing time this weekend, Thursday, Friday, Saturday at Camp Remnant. And we're going to say a couple quick thank yous here in a second, but God showed up. That's just the bottom line. We had multiple people receive Jesus for the first time. Say hallelujah. We had multiple people baptized in the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in tongues. And we had a lot of students who had amazing things. We still don't know all the details. So
students, fill out that QR code survey that we sent you. We want to celebrate with you, but we want to make sure and say thank you to some very special people that made it happen.
Yes, we wanted to give some very quick public thank yous. I'm going to go through it really quickly. But we had an awareness team here keeping us safe. They were great interns, and RCYA, we could not have done it without y'all. They did so many things everywhere. Pastor and our leadership team for always believing in us for our crazy ideas and supporting us. Media and sound, they made everything sound great. And they were so great with live and live stream. Remnant Generations, the dads joined us again for worship, and there's just something amazing about that. The faithful few, the few volunteers that we have every week, they not only come week in and week out to love on your kids, but they showed up all weekend long, praying for them, loving on them, and parents for being patient when the Holy Spirit showed up and we were still going really, really late. You either joined us or you waited, so thank you.
Yeah, and I do have some good news. God doesn't just show up at camp. As long as we're seeking and ready, he shows up wherever and whenever. So parents, we had almost 60 students at this camp. We'd like to see them on Fridays. Bring them to us. We want to hang out with them. We want them to go after Jesus with everything they have. And we're so excited about what God is doing. We love you. Let's worship together as we continue this morning.
I want to invite you guys to stand up on your feet. Come to the altar. You know, in Hebrews it says that Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. How many of y'all believe that? We can go through so many issues. Just thinking like, wow, like this, what I'm going through is horrible, but like, I just want you to have peace and rest knowing that Jesus is the same. So while we're worshiping, let's just take our focus off of ourselves and just put on Jesus, knowing that his promises still stand. Promises. Time and time again, you have proven you'll do just what you say. Though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I'll remain steadfast. And let my heart learn when you speak your word, it will come to pass. Great is your faith. Faithfulness to me. From the rising sun to the setting same, I will praise your name. Great is your faithfulness to me. Thank you.
Faithful. Thank you, Jesus. We thank you because you're a faithful God. You're faithful, Lord. We thank you, Jesus. If you believe he's faithful, can you just worship and praise him just for a few more moments? God, many times we are faithless, but you remain faithful in all moments, in all situations. We are here today to continue to love you and to worship you, Lord. Thank you because you truly are a faithful God. In moments in life where we find it difficult, you're our constant. You remain the same. You're faithful. You're faithful, God. If you believe that, church, can you give them a praise today? Amen. God is good. So if you're a visitor here today, something you're finding out, if you're here for the first time, you're like, man, this church is kind of crazy, right? They're loud and what? There's a word in Spanish. You know, maybe not all of y'all know that word, but guatoso. I don't even know what that word would be in English. Rowdy. I guess it's rowdy, right? And we get a little rowdy, but you know why? We're crazy for Jesus. That's the best way I can say it. We're crazy for Jesus. And we're just super excited that you're here with us today. Will you do me a favor? Turn around real quick. Find two or three people and tell a man, I'm so glad to see you. Give him a big high five and then you may be seated. Give him a big high five. Let him know I'm glad to see you. And then you may be seated. Amen. You guys ready for the Word of God today? Anybody ready for the Word of God? Come on, I'm going to ask again. I think y'all can get more excited about that. Everybody ready for the Word of God today? Amen. So before I introduce our special guest, special speaker today, there's actually a couple special friends I have. So I already mentioned Pastor Ruth. I saw her here in the front. But there's two others I didn't see and got to see when we were greeting each other. And I still don't know where she's at either. I know she's around here somewhere. But an old friend from Bible school, Iris Hawkins, all the way from San Angelo. She's here somewhere. Where you at, Iris? Oh, there she is. Yes, welcome. Good to have her. And then even further back than Bible school, I'm talking about like, man, yeah, I want to say 12, maybe even younger. Just another man of God, minister, and we've known each other for so many years. He's also relative of our special speaker today, but I just want to recognize Minister Mark Molina as well, bro. It's good to see my friend here. He's here with his son as well, and so, man, it's just, I'm telling you, it's a good Sunday. You guys have people here with us today, and so we're so honored to have everybody here with us today. But really, guys, again, like I was saying earlier, we want to definitely, even though we've done so much today, service has got extended usually beyond what we usually do, but we definitely want to give most of the time here to God's word. So I pray that hasn't affected you at all, because we want to give the word the place that it deserves. Amen. And so today it is Mission Sunday, and it truly is an honor to have the special guest that we're here with us today. Now, she's been living in Arkansas for years because, I don't think anybody in this, the Spanish, I think somebody, but there's back when my parents were pastoring,
okay? There was a young man by the name of Johnny Ibarra, and he left to go to Bible school in San Antonio. Then he met his wife, which is Hannah's, well, you're here, and then Mark's sister, right, Lori. They get married. They end up going to Arkansas. They're pastoring Arkansas forever. But the reason I'm saying all that is that because she's originally, I'm going to say this, I'm going to claim her as ours here. She's originally from Fort Worth, let's just say, because, you know, her dad's from there. And I know her mom is from San Antonio as well, but I'm just really excited. But to see in the time I've been able to spend with this young lady, to see what God has placed in her, how he's used her, how he's developed her, and then the excitement to know that now he's called her to missions, and she's going to be a missionary to Japan. And I know she's going to share a little bit of that with you guys. And so, guys, we're going to watch a video first, but if you'll just do me a quick favor, can we just give a big hand clap for the woman of God, Hannah Ibarra? And then let's watch this video.
There is a sound. Can you hear it? It searches for those that will listen. Drifting, distant, desperate. It whispers in the ears of those that believe. It shouts in the streets, straining to be heard through the overwhelming noise. Can you hear us? The collective cry of fallen humanity, devoid of a savior. Centuries have passed without hope. We live here, hidden in the faraway places. Our land, strange. Our culture, a mystery. Our hearts, empty. Our people cling to anything that resembles truth. But what we seek remains out of reach. Our brutal spirits on the edge of breaking. Our prayers unanswered. Our gods stay silent. We are the never reached. We are still waiting.
We hear a sound. It echoes in our ears. It wakes us in our sleep. A voice in the wilderness. A message 2,000 years old. A final command. Go. A simple but profound directive from a saving God. With our victory assured, we journey to the ends of the earth. We climb mountains, trek through jungles, landed on forgotten islands, searching. Many have received, but far too many still remain. Too many haven't heard. Too many don't know. This unfinished task is our urgent kingdom mission. Chosen. Seen. Heard. Called. Can you hear them? Nations. Cities. Tribes. People. They are the never reached. They've waited long enough.
There is a sound.
Can you hear it?
Good afternoon. It's so good to be here. That's a hot mic. Like Pastor Carlos said, my name is Hannah Ibarra. It's always good to be here in the great state of Texas. And I want to talk about how God qualifies the call. So if you were here last night preaching about kind of the same thing, but you're going to hear more about my testimony. So sorry, not sorry. You get to hear it again. So today I want to look at the story of Paul. And we all know Paul. We've heard the name Paul plenty of times. So many people are named Paul, and he's just a pretty popular apostle. He wrote a lot of the New Testament books and wrote a bunch of different letters to believers all over the world and told them, hey, you're doing this good, and hey, you're doing this pretty wrong. So he was a guy that had a good rapport and also kind of a bad one, because who likes being told they're wrong? And I don't want to focus like on all the good things he did. I want to focus on Paul when he was Saul. And so who is Saul? Saul is Paul, but Paul is not Saul. And that sounds like kind of redundant, right? But there's a reason for it. Saul is talked about for a brief period. He's only talked about in the book of Acts for about chapter 8 to chapter 13. But only the sinner Paul, before he became Paul and like before he became like the Jesus-loving guy he is, he's only talked about in 2 chapters. But those 2 chapters of what he did is pretty important. But when he turned into Paul, he's talked about 239 times, which is also pretty important as well. So as we go to the book of Acts, I'm going to give you all time to find that. Scroll, flip through your Bible, find where it's at. I'm going to give you a little background because I like to give a little bit of background to what's happening prior to this because not everybody is familiar with what all the things that happen in the Bible. So it also kind of gives a good foundation like, oh, this is what has happened and this is why this happened. Because if I just told you Paul was part about a murder, you're like, who was murdered? You have to read before that to figure that out. So in chapter 7, there is this man named Stephen who became the first Christian martyr. And the cool thing about that, well, not really cool, but I think it's kind of cool, is I was actually able to go to the place where Stephen is supposedly laid to rest. Because he was the first Christian martyr, he was buried by people in an area where people were like, we don't want this guy here. He just told us all these things that we were doing wrong and was telling us all the bad things and X, Y, Z. And so he's buried now in an unmarked grave in Turkey, which is kind of crazy. Think about that. Like a guy who loved Jesus became the first Christian martyr. You would think he would be somewhere where it's like, this is Stephen, first Christian martyr. Like you would think that you would be able to go and be like, pay your respects, right? No, this man is buried in this overgrown grave. And supposedly he's there, but no one really talks about it. Well, going back to biblical times, Stephen was talking to the Jews, and he was giving them the tough truth. And we know the tough truth is really hard to hear sometimes. We always want the sugar-coated thing. We want something that's going to make us feel better. We don't want the harsh truth. And it says in Acts 7:54, exactly what these people were feeling. When they heard these harsh things, they were enraged and gnashed their teeth. They got so mad that they ended up ambushing him and stoned him to death. And guess what? Saul was in that group. He was part of the martyr of Stephen. And even while Stephen was being buried, Saul went to the church and started destroying it. And he was going house to house, grabbing men and women and putting them into prison. He was like, I'm tired of these people being here. I'm tired of all the things that they're doing. They just need to be gone. So in Acts chapter 9, it starts to talk about where Saul dies and Paul comes to life. And here's what it says in verse 1. Meanwhile, Saul was still breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. He went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogue in Damascus so that if he found any there who belonged to the way, whether men or women, he might take them as prisoners in Jerusalem. So he wasn't happy with just one person dying. He wanted to put more away so this God that they're speaking of can be quiet. As he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from the heavens flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? Who are you, Lord? He replied. Now get up and go into the city. You will be told what you must do. The men traveling with Saul stood there speechless. They heard the sound, but did not see anyone. Saul got up from the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand into Damascus. For 3 days, he was blind and did not eat or drink anything. So Saul was on his way to go after these disciples, and Jesus stopped him. He stopped him because he was being a stubborn dude, and he had a calling upon his life. But you can't go into your calling if you're choosing not to. If you're being stubborn, you're not wanting to listen. This is how I envision it. Jesus basically stopped Saul and was asking, why? Just a simple question. Why are you doing what you're doing? Why are you the way you are? And how would you answer that? Could you think of an answer that quick when Jesus is in front of you asking? I know I probably could not think of an answer. So this is what I think next is kind of like when your parents are disciplining you when you're younger, they usually send you to the corner, the timeout corner, and you need to sit there with your eyes to the wall, not looking at anything and think about what you've done, right? So he probably made Saul blind so he could think about what he was doing. He wasn't able to think about what he saw or anybody's face. He just had to think about what he did. That makes sense. You'll take 3 days to think about what you've done. He didn't eat, he didn't drink. So all he had to do was think. Later, God sent Ananias to meet Saul, and this is where we're going to pick up in verse 17. Then Ananias went to the house and entered it. Placing his hands on Saul, he said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you were coming here, has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit." Immediately, something like scales fell from Saul's eyes, and he could see again. He got up and was baptized, and after taking some food, he regained his strength. Saul spent several days with the disciples in Damascus. At once, he began to preach in the synagogue that Jesus is the Son of God. So literally, he was given his vision back. He ate a little bit, and I'm assuming this all happened in the same day, because if it was through multiple days, they would probably say after resting. They just said he ate and got some energy and started preaching that Jesus is the Son of God. He was preaching the same thing that the people he was going after. He was preaching the same thing that got Stephen killed. He was preaching the same thing that got people imprisoned. And I think that's just kind of crazy about how if you take time to think and actually process, God can change your thoughts. And you can see why this is where Saul turns into Paul, and how Saul is Paul, but Paul is not Saul. In chapter 13, verse 8, this is where it happens, where the name change, and it's very quick. Said, but Elimias the sorcerer, that is what his name means, opposed him and tried to turn the proconsul from the faith. Then Saul, who was also called Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, looked straight at Elimias and said, "You are the child of the devil and an enemy of everything that is right. You are full of all kinds of deceit and trickery. You will never stop perverting the right ways of the Lord. Now, the hand of the Lord is against you. You are going to be blind for a time, not even able to see the light of the sun." Immediately, mist and darkness came over him, and he reached his hand out, seeking for someone to lead him by the hand. So in a split moment in this story, you see that Saul is now named Paul. It's nothing like this big transition, like some miraculous moment God comes down and says, "You are no longer named Saul. You are now Paul." It's literally just a split of a second. So if you're just skimming the Bible, you're like, don't lie. Some of y'all skim the Bible. We all kind of sometimes skim the Bible to look what we're looking for. You could miss that shift. It says Paul. He is now named Paul, no longer named Saul. And every time after that, you hear him as Paul. So Saul is Paul, but Paul isn't Saul. Paul would never be the one to kill Christians. For now, he is Christian. He has been changed. He would never be the one to throw in people into prison. But Saul did. And Saul could change. He changed to the person to share the gospel. Because Paul had a calling. He needed to change, and God did that change in him. It didn't matter what he had done in the past. He was literally killing Christians. It didn't matter. God still had a calling for him. He was one of the greatest missionaries ever, speaking the gospel to the people who had no idea that Christ was around them. There are so many people out there who don't know all the good things that God can do. They don't know his good news. I didn't know. I don't know if you're aware, but Paul is no longer around. He kind of was in biblical times, so he's not here anymore. He's not physically here, but he's still here spiritually, still spreading the good news through the Bible. Y'all, I didn't think about this with my words that I was writing down. So now someone has to take everything that Paul has written, everything that God has given him to share, and physically take it to other people since Paul's no longer here to do that. And I don't know if you know this, but this year's like missions theme is Christ among us. And through Paul's story and a bunch of stories throughout the Bible, you can see how Christ is around all the time. But no one knows until someone comes up and preaches it to them, shares the message with them. Y'all know I try not to say it. So who is going to let them know? Who believes God has a calling on their life? Not everybody said it, which is true. Some people think they don't have a calling upon their life. But we all do. Some people might think they don't have a calling because of things they've done, things they are going through, they have done too much, things have happened to them, they're too far broken, but that's not true. God uses all of you for his calling upon your life. And for me, that was really hard to believe. I didn't think I could be called to be a missionary associate, like, out into the world. Who wants a 25-year-old girl who is kind of just living her life, going to school, college girl, still taking way too long to finish college, to go out to be an associate pastor in Japan? I was like, not me. That's a scary title to have. I didn't want that. I definitely could have never thought as a teenager that this is where I would be today. Because I'm someone who is so awkward at meeting new people. I'm such an introvert, and you come up to me and say hi, I'm just going to say hi back. It's really hard for me to start a conversation with you. I'm the girl who likes to stay in the background, who would like to be upstairs in that sound booth rather than down here because less people see me up there. I am a girl who can hardly even learn Spanish, so why are you going to send me to a country to learn Japanese? Why would I be called? I am a girl that has a history of anxiety that was so crippling that I would just have mental paralysis where I would be know in here that I could move, but out here, I could not get myself to move at all. I was just stuck. I'm a girl who has a history of depression who would let her thoughts take her in such a dark hole that I felt like nothing could pull me out of it. Such a dark hole that led me to like such suicidal ideation. I thought about it many times. Because I felt like I'm going through all these things. I have to like admit to people that I was sexually abused as a kid, and how am I supposed to let my family know that? How am I supposed to let the people who care about me know? And everything that's coming with it as I come to process it and come to heal from it. I felt like being such a burden because the anxiety and depression that came with it was becoming way too much. I didn't think all these things would help me come to where I am today. Because God's like, you think if you were away from all those things, I could use you for my calling. But in reality, he's using all of those things to bring me to my calling. I was someone who didn't want anything to do with ministry. My dad's a pastor, so it's kind of like expected that his kids would go into ministry. I wanted nothing to do with ministry. I kind of wanted just to go to church, and that's it. I didn't want to serve anywhere. I just wanted to go to church. And I thought I would be good with that. And I tried. Let me tell you, I tried just to do that. But God has a way to pulling you to the place where you're supposed to be. And he has pulled me to go through so many trials, learn so many new things, learn how to reach people, learn how not to reach people, how to lead people and how not to lead people, all to come to this moment. I'm someone who hates the cold. Hates the cold. But I'm going to a place where it snows like that every winter even more. That's an easy picture. I'm looking at a place that gets 12 feet of snow every winter. And he's called me to go there. He's called me to go to the place that is not very English friendly, to learn Japanese, to be able to survive, to reach the people out in Misawa. Like I said before, I did not believe this is where I would be. I believed I was far too broken. I had experienced way too much that God could not use me. And everything that comes with being the title of a pastor, I was like, one, I am not a great speaker. My mind goes way too fast for me to talk. And sometimes I get jumbled up and I have to take a moment. And usually you think of pastors. Pastors have very clear speech and they're able to say what they want to say in the effective way with the right words. And like, I don't have that. I don't feel like I have the appropriate Bible knowledge to like share with people like, hey, this is the gospel and this is what you should know, right? I didn't feel like I have that. I don't even have my minister's license. And I was like, you want me to be a pastor and I don't even got my minister's license? But God is pulling me to be qualified. I have submitted that application, took my test, and now I just wait for my interview. He's getting me one step closer. He is pulling me closer more into the word and giving me more of an understanding of the word because I am choosing to do it. That's the key part. Is choosing to follow through and choosing to listen. Because he can't force you to do anything. He gave us free will for a reason. He wants you to want it. And a lot of the conversations that I've had with God, he's continually to remind me about why I am called. He wants me there because there is someone out there who needs to hear the gospel from my lips because they will only hear it from me. For whatever reason, they're only going to hear it from me. Didn't matter my story. So you had Paul, who was once called himself the worst sinner of all, literally murdered Christians, had such a great calling on his life. You had me, who was like a broken person, to go out called into the world. I'm going to tell you some few other people. You have Tamar. Like these three people that I'm going to mention have very important significance. So you have Tamar. Tamar literally seduced her father-in-law and had a baby with him. Tricked him, the whole thing, got him drunk, all is crazy. It's a crazy story. The Bible's full of crazy stories. If you don't know that, you need to read it more. And then there comes Rahab. Rahab was a prostitute. A woman who sold her body, but God had a calling for her. God had a calling for Tamar. God had a calling for King David. And I don't know if you know this, but King David is also a murderer and also an adulterer. But God had a calling on his life. He used every single one of these people with their sins and all to fulfill his calling. These three people that I mentioned are part of the lineage of Jesus. These people, sins and all, led to the greatest gift of all coming to earth. So if God can use these people that I've mentioned, he can use you. It's only you who is stopping yourself. God qualifies the called. He's called me. He's called you. And you might be thinking, Hannah, I'm not called to go to another country. it's not just about going. It's about being present and interceding. You're like, what is interceding? Interceding is praying on behalf of someone else. So when you're praying for someone's healing, that's interceding. When you're praying for a good day for your brothers and sisters, that's interceding on their behalf. Interceding is something we do all the time without even thinking about it. But right now, I'm asking you to be intentional in your intercession. When there are a bunch of those that are overseas and who don't know the gospel, and the only way that's going to happen is by God showing up to them or someone else showing up. Be present. So there's those that are overseas that God is calling to go overseas. But I'm also calling you to be present. Be present where you are today and be bold. It's really hard to go up to somebody you don't know, especially if you're an introvert like myself, and just say, hey, Jesus loves you. Simple as that. It could be really hard to go up to somebody who looks straight intimidating, but that's probably the person that needs to hear it the most. Be present and be willing to share what God has done in your life. All you guys here that just were at camp, y'all have testimonies from camp, but are you going to keep those testimonies to yourself? Or are you actually going to do something with it? Because if you keep it to yourself, you kind of went to this whole thing for nothing. Because your story is for those, for other students as well. If you don't share with your friends, who is? If you don't share with them, are they going to believe them? They know you. They may not know me, but they know you. So they're more likely to believe everything that you have to say. Whether if I were to go up and say it to them, they're like, this is just chick. She's just another preacher. But if they hear it from you because they know you and how you are, they're going to be willing to listen. Take that second thought, because sometimes all you need is a second thought. Sometimes you just need a moment. Like my whole tagline for my team is capture the moment. Capture moments. Because sometimes that's all you need is a split moment to share what God has done in your life. So that you can also capture lives. Because if you don't capture the life, what's going to happen to them? Is there going to be someone else that's going to come along and share? Or were you that person that God has called you to do? Were you the person called to share with your friend? Think about everything that's happening on social media, everything that's coming out in the movies. There are all these, I love documentaries. I love documentaries because it just gives me more things to learn about. But a bunch of documentaries that are coming out today are against the church. It's everything that the church is doing wrong. And where are the documentaries about what the church does right? Where are the documentaries about lives being changed? There's four-part series about this is what this pastor did, this is what they did, and this is how they pushed this thing aside. I'm not saying these things that the churches have done wrong should be swept under the rug. No, they should be acknowledged. But we also need to acknowledge the good thing that God does. We need to be willing to share it out, not just easily repost this scandal that popped up. There are a bunch of people around us that will never walk into a church because of what they're seeing on social media and what they're seeing out in the world. So if they're never going to walk into a church, how are they going to hear the Bible? How are they going to hear the message? How are they going to hear the life-saving things God does? They're not. It's on you. You are called. Your kids are called. Your friends are called. But they can't fulfill their promise unless you choose to share and they choose to follow. And I'm not saying you have to do this alone. We're in a church for a reason. We're a family. We're all part of one body. We are a part of the church. One church. Not just the Fort Worth churches, not just the Dallas churches, not just the Arkansas churches. We're all part of one church. One body of Christ. One goal. One calling. This is something that you share with your friends that you've created here in your internship. Be like, hey, I want to share this with so-and-so, or so-and-so is going through a hard time. What can I do? You're not meant to figure it out by yourselves. You have your peers right beside you. You have your leaders. You have your pastors that are here to help you. They have there are people ready to pray with you. There are people ready to intercede with you. And some of you, you don't know what you're doing with your life. You're like, might be a senior, might be a young adult, going to college, still don't know what you're doing with your life. And that's okay. Because maybe God has a calling for you that you just haven't heard yet. Or maybe you have an idea of what, this is what I'm going to go do. I'm going to graduate. I'm going to go get a job here. I'm going to do this, get married, have a family, have kids. You have it all planned out. But maybe God has something different. I had things planned. I was a pre-med major when I entered school. And now I'm a counseling major. Completely two different things. I had a plan and life was hard, but it wasn't until I got on my knees and decided to listen that I heard my true calling. It wasn't until I got on my knees and I let God speak over me, speak all the truth and push out all the lies that I was giving to myself. It wasn't until I let God speak to me and say, it doesn't matter what you've done, even though you knew it was wrong, you still did it anyways, but I still have a calling for you. That didn't go away. God has called us to go and to intercede and be present. You might be like, I'm kind of scared to meet people. Start off with interceding. Start off with praying for those people who have never heard the gospel. I don't know if you know this, but Japan has the second highest population of unreached people. Because they are a very close-knit community. And if you're not in their circle, you're not getting in. It takes years of building relationship to get into that circle to even mention something. And you got to mention it the right way so you don't get pushed right back out. But those people that are there, they need you to help intercede for those Japanese people or for those Muslim people or for those Hindu people or those post-Christian people or those atheists. Some people are just tired of God and want nothing to do with it because they felt like they've seen enough, but they haven't seen enough because they don't know the truth. They only know the bad, not the good. Because the good outweighs the bad. God needs you to reach different people all around because someone needs to hear what God can do through your lips and only your lips. I want you to stand up and close your eyes and think about this. God called Paul, the worst sinner of all. God called Tamar. God called Rahab a prostitute. God called King David a murderer and adulterer. But yet he still used them to fulfill his calling to bring Jesus here. So he could be someone to save us. And if God did all these things for people today to get saved and hear what he has to say and be healed and see the miracles and live eternally in heaven. But they're waiting for someone. He's waiting for someone to listen to their calling. Are you willing to listen? Or do you have something that's holding you back? Are you in a relationship that's holding you back, that you're in it because you're trying to make this relationship work, but it's pushing you away from God's calling? Do you have some unforgiveness in your heart? Like you need to forgive someone because someone did something wrong to you. And you're like, if they're a Christian and they did this, I don't want to be a part of that, God. But we're human. We live in a broken world. We're all going to make mistakes. Do you need to forgive somebody? Are you going to do it or are you going to let it hold you back? Do you need to apologize to someone? Do you need to suck it up, be humble, and realize that you've done wrong and that you're not perfect? Because sometimes those small things that keep being brought up to mind, like, oh, no, I didn't do anything wrong. It was all them. Is the Holy Spirit trying to show you what you did wrong? And it could be holding you back from the best part of your calling. Are you just scared? You're scared of the unknown. The unknown is scary. I'm a planner. I don't like going into something not knowing what's happening. But sometimes we need to take that leap of faith and go into the unknown. Because if we go into the known, we're only going to get half the blessing. Because God wants us to go into the unknown. Can you hear him calling you? Or do you need to leave something at his feet first? Can you hear the never reached yearning for God? Can you hear the calling that he has for every single person? Because he's chose you. You are called to go. You are called to intercede and you are called to be present. So these altars are open that if you need to be able to hear God's calling more, come up here and focus on him. Don't let the person that's back of the head distract you. Come to the front, get on your knees, surrender it all, and listen for his calling. Or get on your knees and surrender all the bad habits that you have, all that you've sins that you've done, all the negative thoughts that you have about yourself. Leave what you need to at the altar so God can use you for his calling, because we are all called. But are you willing to take that calling? Every person is chosen. Every person is seen. Every person is heard. And every person is called. Nobody's just pushed aside. Everybody has a calling. And some people might think, no, I'm done. I did what I did. I thought I was on the right path, but I did something wrong. No, it's okay. If God can use all these people in the Bible, he can still use you. Don't let the world tell you that he can't use you anymore, because that's a lie. Are you going to be willing to listen to the truth and tell the truth to those around you? Are you going to be willing to listen and hear the calling? Thank you.
speak to me.
All the pastors and leaders and altar workers, let's pray, let's minister. Front of the back, just keep your eyes closed. We've been challenged today, challenged and reminded that we're all called. You know, I know we do have a tendency sometimes when we talk about missions or calling, in many ways we kind of already check out, right? Like, that's not me, that's not the category I'm in. But we've been reminded, we heard the message today, we're all called. And I like this. She had mentioned there's things you have to give up in order to step into your calling. So I would say that's your challenge today. What is it? Is it bitterness? Is it anger? Is it lack of forgiveness? What is it that you have to give up today because God's calling you into something greater? It's not an issue of you don't have a calling. It's just an issue of what you're willing to give up to follow Him. So right now you're saying, Lord, I'll give you my time, my family. I'll give you my bitterness. I'll give it to you because I know you've called me. So allow the Lord to continue to speak to you, encourage you, challenge you. These altars are still open. If you didn't come on the first time, you're still more than welcome to come. But with this same spirit, I do want to do this. We do our best to never let this opportunity pass. With every eye closed, and I ask that kindly and respectfully just to do this one to another. If everybody in this place, even if you're at your seats, can you just close your eyes for a few moments? And if there's somebody here today that you're sick and tired of being sick and tired, because the challenge today was to the church, to those that already know Christ and going and knowing we're calling and stepping out. But maybe for some of you, this is the first time you're even hearing about Christ. Or maybe for you, you've heard about Christ, but you said, today I got to come to church. There's something pulling me in. I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired, and I want to give my life to Jesus Christ. I always like to say it this way. You're willing to give your entire life for eternal life. And you know you're not here by coincidence or by accident today. And so with every man and woman of God here from our church helping me pray and intercede, if that's you today, you say, I want to give my life to Jesus. When I count to three, I want you to shoot your hand up. Somebody's going to come and pray with you. And we have even a hospitality room after service that come and love to continue to pray with you and give you a gift and get to know you better. But right now, here's your moment where you say, you know what? That's it. I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired. I'm going to give my life to Christ. And maybe you're that person that you did a long time ago, but we believe that you can backslide and get away from that and want to renew that vow, renew that relationship once again. That's you too. So when I count to three all over this place, we won't force the moment, but we do give opportunity. I want you to raise your hand and say, that's me. Whether for the first time or you're rededicating your life once again to Christ. That's how I want to give my life to Jesus, totally. I surrender, as this song is saying, I surrender my life to Jesus. If this is you, are you ready? I'm going to count to three. You shoot that hand up high so we know who you are. One, two, three. Is there anybody in this place who would say, I want to give my life to Jesus Christ today? There's one hand, another hand back there. Come on, somebody get excited with me. Three in Spanish. We got two. I don't know if missing anybody else here. The Bible says that the angels rejoice when somebody gives their life to Christ. Church, will you help me get excited just for a little bit? There's two people that raise their hands. God is doing something. Their eternity has changed. I hope there's, thank you. They are praying for them already. Father, I thank you because you have spoken to us today. I thank you because there's young people here today, high schoolers, young adults, adults, all feeling the calling. And Hannah said it, we're all called. But sometimes there's that fear of, are you sure it's me, or I'm too broken, or I'm not equipped enough, or I'm not qualified enough. But it couldn't have been said more clear that we all are called. Be present. Be present. Intercede in the now. Give in the now. Help in the now, wherever it is. And leave behind what we need to leave as you call us into those greater things. Some you'll call to overseas. Some you'll call here to Fort Worth. But Lord, let us just respond and be obedient to the call that you have for us. Thank you, Jesus. Can we sing the chorus, worship team? Can we sing the chorus just one more time? And with this, we'll begin to start concluding our service today. Let's worship him.
I surrender.
Altar. So please stay in the moment, stay in what God's doing in your life, stay however long you need as God continues to deal with you. For the rest of us, just a few things we always like to repeat and remind you guys. If you gave your life to Christ, if you raise your hand, a couple ways you can connect with us. You can stop at the hospitality room. They're ready for you, ready to love on you. I've always said it this way: we have some of our friendliest people in that room ready for you to pray with you today. But another thing you can do is you can text the word new walk to the number 94000. If you gave your life to the Lord, you can text that word new walk and somebody will connect with you throughout the week. Maybe you didn't give your life to the Lord. Maybe you're just here today for the first time and you want to get to know more about the church. Well, we're going to ask you to text the word refuge guest. Text the word refuge guest to the same number, 94000. And we'll connect with you and help you learn more about the church and how you can get connected. This Wednesday, don't forget, we have prayer. Not on Tuesday, but on Wednesday. Will you come? It's been low lately, so I'm going to invite you guys. It's our summer prayer service. And maybe some of you weren't quite sure and all that stuff. So can I just invite you this Wednesday, 7 o'clock for prayer. Let's have a good time in the Lord. And then lastly, next Sunday, as I mentioned earlier, next Sunday is our Redefine graduation. We're going to have some special things going on in the morning. So we invite you to come and be a part of that. But also come back in the evening at 6 o'clock. It's our night of worship. We'll get into some worship. The interns will be doing worship. We'll have graduation time. And then our worship team will also help us as well. Amen. Guys, go to the back, please. Get to know Hannah. She's one of the friendliest young ladies you'll ever meet. Right, Hannah? Is that true? Right? Okay. And get a prayer card. Get to know more about what God is doing and how God is using her all over the world. But here's the last thing we're going to do before we dismiss. Are you ready? Ushers, will you get ready here? Now, I know most of you give online, so I'm going to ask you, those that give online, will you pull out your phone? It's okay to pull out your phone at church. Go ahead. Come on, you can start pulling out your phones. Because sometimes we say give on, and then you expect to do it after service, and you never did. But if you go to the Tithely app, there's a special link that talks about it's either missions or special speaker. You can give to either one of those links when you go to the Tithely app. And ushers, if you're here, we want to pick up a special offering for our missionary. How many love Hannah? How many love her? Amen? We can do something not just in Fort Worth. We can do it around the world. I'm going to say this really quickly. Maybe not everybody knows, and we bring missionaries quite a bit. We try to bring them quite often. But there's two things that happen with missionaries. There's two things that happen with missionaries, and it's this. There's their monthly budget that they have to raise, and then there's, you know, special offering or projects and other things. Hannah's barely in that first phase of raising her budget. We as a church, we will make a commitment to Hannah to help with her monthly budget, but we also want to give her a special offering. And so I'm just going to challenge you guys. Let's give a sacrificial offering. The way I said it in Spanish, I want you to give an offering that hurts just a little bit. Are you okay with that? What kind of offering is that? That's that offering that you're saying, oh, man, if I give this, then I'm not going to be able to go to McDonald's after all, right? I don't know if anybody was going to go to McDonald's. But what I'm saying is that it may hurt you in the human side, but you know when you obey God, God will always bless you and prosper you and double it. Anybody know what I'm talking about? So I'm going to ask you to just really hear God, allow the Holy Spirit to speak to you. I'm not that type of pastor. I don't believe in it. Where it's like, I want to have 10 people, $100. Like we don't do that. Because we believe we limit the Holy Spirit by doing that. The Holy Spirit's talking to you. All I'm telling you is I'm challenging you, give beyond what you usually give. Are you okay with that? Let's pray. Father, we come before you. And we thank you for who you are, God. We thank you for this message. We've been challenged. Some of us got a little bit more tender to your calling and said, I want to respond and I'll leave behind. Others here, we got a little bit more stiff. We became even a little bit more stubborn. We doubled down and said, no, that's not for me. No, I don't want to do that. But Father God, I do believe you're speaking to so many of us here today. It says, I want to respond, God. If you're calling me, it's only because you have something greater for me. You're not trying to hurt me. You have something greater for me, and I want to respond. I want to respond to that calling. Father, I bless everybody here today that's going to give an offering. I know they gave their tithes, and that which we already know there's a blessing that we do weekly, or again, as we paid biweekly, or however that may be. And so we gave that. But this is a special offering. This is an offering that represents us giving to missions and giving to souls around the world and being able to be a part of. We may never get to go to Japan, but Hannah is, and we can go with her in this way. We can intercede with her, and we can give and be a part of what God is doing in her life on the other side of the world, and that we ourselves are also helping her reach lives, and thus we're reaching lives too. Father, will you bless your people as they give unto you? And Father, will you bless this service as well? We don't dismiss from your presence. Your presence always goes with us, but we dismiss from this service, God. We thank you. In your precious name we pray, amen. And amen. Guys, bring your offering. If you're that tight, bring it up here. Give it online. But you're officially dismissed. Give somebody a hug. Give somebody a handshake. And we will see you here this week.